Hello, my name is Stephen Hopkins. I'm the director of this film, and as himself.
Geoffrey Rush, hello, commentary buffs, I hope.
Here comes Geoffrey now. We wanted to put this at the beginning of the film. We want to show Geoffrey at the height of his archetypal Sellers look, and of course to introduce him as the designer and creator of this whole idea. We had an animated sequence which was quite short in the original script, but we decided to expand it for a lot of different reasons. You know, one, to show that Sellers was playing every different role almost in the film.
Bit like an old-fashioned theatrical prologue where you get the idea of the whole piece presented as a sort of entertaining dumb show.
Right. And also, if you look closely at the animation too, it's very, you know, silly and bright and witty as a lot of those 70s starters were. Obviously, there's elements of the Pink Panther beginnings here, you know. But also there's a certain dark, strange qualities, because even though everyone's having fun and being jolly, people are being consistently attacked or wiped out accidentally by Sellers, who's hurting people without even realizing what he's doing. Like, electrocuting the grips.
Yeah. Well, that whole sequence with the goons, because in the original script there was the idea of the film starting with the lovemaking scene, mm-hmm. with Britt and Peter in the middle of his career, and he's raced to hospital and of course then turns and morphs into the doctor that's treating him.
Right, while he's having a heart attack.
And the goons race in out of nowhere in a sort of running, jumping, standing still style of film, and through a lot of goonish gibberish take him back to the happier days of doing the Goon Show.
But that proved to be so anarchic and so chaotic. We showed it a couple of times to people who really felt that they were so lost in that when the film began, it sort of left them behind. In this version, we have the cartoon ending and the life and death of Peter Sellers sign fizzing out an empty studio. So we're saying that it's not all going to be a bunch of laughs from here on. And the goons put a lot of time into this, didn't we?
Yes, well, we were thrown in the deep end a little, because for the wide shots, just for the economics of using the extensive crowd of 70 extras or whatever it was, we had to shoot the scene, including the audience, in the master shot. So we basically went on cold, and it felt like we were doing a live goon show. It was spooky, but a lot of fun. And there were two wonderful women in the audience as extras who had actually been to the recordings of the Goon Show up at Camden in the 50s. And it was our first positive review, because she said, oh, you guys have just nailed it. It feels like we're there 50 years ago. So that was very rewarding for us, because we know that these figures are just great, great comic icons.
There's a lot of resistance to having this goon section in the film, because people felt like no one would know who they were. But for me, that wasn't important. It was more important to see Sellers as a part of this anarchic Sex Pistols-like group from the 50s. And you didn't have to listen to everything they were saying there. You just had to see the effect they had on each other and the audience, you know, the fact that they were probably all drunk or...
Yes, I think they had a traditional couple of slugs of whiskey, from reliable sources. And later in life, of course, Sellers always said that this was the favourite period of his life.
Mm-hmm.
Every Sunday they'd go off and do the Goon Show, which ran for, what, nine years, I think.
Right. I think there's something that he never recovered from the Goon. With the Goons, anything was possible. It was all sound effects. If you wanted to have the three goons running around someone's brain, you could do it on the radio. Years later, they tried to do a TV series with puppets, and it failed miserably, because as soon as you started putting it on the screen, then you lost all that magic, you know? And I think that frustrated him about film a little bit, so that you couldn't just do what you wanted to. You had to plan it all, and it had to be lit. You had to build a set, and, you know, that spontaneity really suited him, I think.
And this scene is very much about the fact that he was a very unlikely candidate for the film celebrity that he was about to achieve within a couple of years. I think the other goons always gave him a hard time, because the idea of a British film star at that point was very much, certainly on an international level, were people from the classical school like Alec Guinness, or a big international movie star like David Niven. And Spike, I think it was said, you know, Peter could have been a very good regional British bank manager, because he didn't particularly have what was regarded then as the qualities of a film star. But they had made lots of films, hadn't they? They did the Running, Jumping, Standing Still film and Penny Points to Paradise. There's Zed Men. There's quite a number of short, mad films they made throughout the 50s.
Yeah, I think Michael Bentine in those days, when the Goonies, he was much more into film than the rest of them. He sort of headed in that direction. And this is, of course, post-war Britain in the 50s, which is a kind of strange time, because it was so old-fashioned and traditional, but it was just entering that new boom period where everything was becoming very groovy.
Well, I think rationing lasted well into the 50s here, didn't it? It was sort of a relatively tough life. And, of course, Peg, played by Miriam, and Bill, the father, were both music hall artists who had taken cellars all through his childhood. He had a very rootless existence, and I think that affected his adult personality a lot, because he found it very hard to settle down in one place.
When Sellers looked young, he looked older, didn't he? It was one of the difficult things in the film. We didn't realize, because he was larger and in these old-fashioned clothes, he actually looked older as a young man, and often played older men when he was young and then younger men as he was old.
I think in the 50s, if you were in your 30s, you were sort of
middle-aged.
Yeah, it was regarded, I suppose, as being middle-aged in a way. Because I remember John Lennon always saying in the very early days of their success that he couldn't imagine being a Beatle when he was 35.
Right.
But it's now possible, you know, to be a Rolling Stone and be well into your 60s.
Oh, you've got this gigantic fat suit on here too. I remember Spike Milligan saying that Sellers was so lazy he wouldn't even want to lean down and tie his own shoelaces up, so he wore slip-ons. And his mother used to come and feed him enormous breakfast every morning. Miriam Margolyes plays Peg. And for some reason, Sellers always called her Peg, not Mum or anything. They were very close. And Peter Vaughan plays Bill, the father. And, of course, Peter Vaughan did a film with Sellers, The Blockhouse.
Which I don't think ever got released.
No, you can only get it on video. I got a bad copy on video to watch it. And it was quite a good film, actually. And he told us some great stories of Sellers, I guess, who was on one of his bad movies at that point. Sellers often did films that he felt he should do, and then as he was doing them, he'd get so angry. And because I think they often reflected where he was in his life, you know. It was a very claustrophobic, dark film, and I think that always affected him.
I don't believe a man's worth can be summed up on a piece of paper. It wouldn't be fair to me, or to you.
Cobblers, of course, Mr. Cobblers pops up. He's another character that I think Sellers dropped into very easily. He was always the guy who would be the doorman at the BBC complaining about people coming in with long hair. Or
right, on the album, the record album, yeah. Too. There's record albums.
Mr. Cobblers. And there's a little bit in here, I suppose, that is kind of an homage to the character that he plays in The Smallest Show on Earth when he plays the older cinema projectionist. This scene, I think, is based on the fact that he did, in the early days of radio, he phoned the head of the BBC and pretended to be Kenneth Horne, who was then the current big on-air star. He phoned up and said it was Ken and said, "You've got to go and see this marvellous comic. I think you should give him a job." And by the end of the call, he confessed and said, "Well, it's me, it's Peter Sellers." And he did get a gig from that.
Sweetie in view. This is Jeffrey playing the ukulele, recorded on set, one take. I think I introduced his home movie idea, which wasn't originally in the script, just because when I saw this home movie footage that Sellers had, which is hundreds of hours of stuff, and I saw 7 or 8 hours of it, and I sent it to Jeffrey too before we started, it was revealing how Sellers wanted his home movies to make his life look so joyful. And there was a theme that ran through all of them. He wanted everything to look a bit like a kid's birthday party, I thought, which was revealing about him. And then when you watched the home movie footage, you realize he'd do multiple takes, which kind of belies spontaneity. And he wanted his life to look perfect in every way, and that's the only way he wanted to see it. And this is from I'm All Right Jack, which is actually shot at Shepperton, where we shot. In fact, they used Shepperton as the factory from that movie. And we were able to shoot a lot of the... we shot the Doctor Strangelove section on the same stage they shot Doctor Strangelove.
I'm All Right Jack.
This was a very big time, I think, in his career, because as an actor that studied him a lot in preparation for the film, between the mid-50s and 64, he probably made, 12 or 15 films. And as a character actor, they're unsurpassed, I think. I mean, Fred Kite, that he won this BAFTA for, Smallest Show on Earth, The Mouse That Roared, working with Kubrick twice on Lolita and then Strangelove, and doing the first big commercial Hollywood film with The Pink Panther in 63. I think most actors that I know who are familiar with that period of his work at that point regard it as just an astonishing achievement.
It's a whole career in itself. People don't realize that in this film, from when we first see him at the Goons to when he's at the Pink Panther, is only about 6 years. Mm. It feels like this huge period of time. Mm. Of course, now, this is the first transformation that we have left in the film, where Jeffrey becomes his own father. And the idea behind this was that Sellers had so little self-awareness that he could only have an opinion of himself when he inhabited people who were close to him and could then see himself properly.
I never questioned this as a device. When I read it, I just thought, oh, this is so fantastic. This could easily happen in the theatre and no one would blink an eye. But it seemed a very apt technique, because if you've got a central character who has a difficulty with his own sense of identity, it seemed to be a very ingenious device from the writers to be able to get him to express and articulate things that Bill wouldn't be able to articulate, because I gather Bill was a very sort of quietly transparent figure in Sellers' life. But had he been able to talk, which Sellers takes on that role, he's able to articulate a lot of the, give you a little capsule of the home life where Peg would never say no to Peter. She gave him, in lots of ways, no parameters of behavior that would be normal for most people in terms of...
I think she encouraged his anarchy, I think. If he really wanted to express himself wildly in an angry or bright way, she would just, push that, I think.
What does it feel like to be co-starring with Sophia Loren?
Soft, warm, a little like being a young boy in a bakery. Very early in the morning.
It must have been very exciting for Sellers to have met the most glamorous film star in the world at this point. I think round about here, Sophia Loren had either just won the Oscar or was just about to.
Just about to, I think, for Two Women, which was 61. This was a little earlier. But she really did represent international, exotic beauty, didn't she, in terms of the film world?
Absolute antithesis of being British, too. Everything about her was just the opposite of what being British was all about, which was, she has no reservations.
Now, in subsequent chats, of course, that I've had with Michael and Sarah, the two children, who are now closer to my age, we met after the Cannes premiere. They had a private screening for Anne Sellers and Michael and Sarah and their children, William and Emily. And this was an area that Michael felt, I think, a little more uncomfortable with, because he feels as though the film presents this as a kind of delusional fantasy completely on Sellers' side. But he feels that there were enough signals, perhaps, from Sophia Loren that she was radiating a lot of fabulous eye contact. But there, again, that may have been a natural part of her very glamorous persona, that she liked to be admired on set and, liked to be generous with the company. And of course, Sellers either misread that or, you know, they had a marvellous time, but I could never get to the bottom of the fact of whether an affair really happened or whether it was in his mind. But the writers have certainly used it as a way of showing that this particular almost adolescent personality had difficulty with his very first brush with international celebrity, and it became something that he didn't handle particularly well.
I mean, there's some things. She's Italian and very Latin, obviously, which is quite different. You know, and Italians will touch your hand, or, you know, they touch you, whereas English people, of course, in those days wouldn't do that.
Different body
but I think she has a reputation for being extraordinarily flirtatious. And some people will be very flirtatious, and that'll have no effect on you. But if Sophia Loren, at the age of 24, is flirtatious with you, a sort of 30-something-year-old chubby English fellow, then you're going to be completely wowed over by it, I think. You know, but because Sellers is an extreme character, he, of course, takes it one step further than anyone else would, or several steps, I think. And in his mind, I'm sure he thought that this was the destiny, this was the great marriage that had to be, because he'd never met anyone like her. I mean, there's not many people like her anyway. But when I spoke to Sonia Aquino in the first place about it, I said, you know, I think who's met Sophia Loren, I said, you have to be that really flirtatious Italian, you know, superstar. You know, nowadays, supermodels or whatever like that. You meet them and then they are just...
They come from similar geographical backgrounds, I think, just outside of Naples, the same...
Near Perugia, I think. The same area that Monica Bellucci came from, too. There's a sort of Italian type that comes from there. Lucky old Perugians. I think unconsciously, I feel, too, that he felt like he was starting to have an affair behind his wife's back. But because, once again, I kind of felt like that would never surface to his consciousness, that, not that this is anything Jeffrey played, obviously, but I sense that this part of his life, he became more explosive because he felt like he was doing something wrong or something was wrong, and he couldn't put his finger on what was wrong, and he would lash out. And it's also quite illuminating, too, if you look at this whole next section of the film and really the whole of his life, you know, going back to him wanting his home movies to look like children's birthday parties, he would treat his children as peers. He wouldn't treat them, he wouldn't sense a difference in ages very much. He didn't realize that they would have a different emotional sense or experience than he would.
And this young boy, James, is like an extraordinary actor. I find that scene between him and Emily, just there's a deep undercurrent of... just as an actor, there's a troubled... shattered inner life going on in that boy that is not being expressed, but they happen to be playing Ludo or whatever they're doing together.
Well, it must be so confusing for a child, I think.
And then the gifts. I think this again is based on fact that the gifts to repair the damage would be extremely generous and offered with great generosity and love, and almost like there was no recall that the blowout or the explosion or the tantrum, which he'd had, I think, a lot through his adolescence, had ever existed or happened.
And once again, I think because Sellers probably felt enormous guilt, he would need to put it on film to see his son happy again. Mm. And Anne Sellers, Emily Watson, you know, playing Anne, Anne Sellers, in lots of her interviews, she's explained that the whole house is always full of lights and wires and cables because Sellers used to film everything and edit everything in an edit room that he had in the barn of this giant estate in Chipperfield. And I think it was very important to him, not consciously, very important to him to make sure that he could look at that film and see his son happy again, that he hadn't deeply hurt him. You know, he wanted to see him smile at the camera. He wanted to... I think that's one of the only ways he could have a real intimate relationship with him, even though, you know, he was actually pretty well known to play with the kids a lot. It's just he had no sense of what to do if conflict happened, I think. In this scene, obviously, with Anne here, he doesn't really understand what the problem is. He doesn't understand the complications that arise from having damaged his son and then repaired it. He thinks it's all over, isn't it? I mean, she was a very important figure in his life.
And having met Anne and seen, well, I felt as if I knew her because I'd seen her interviewed in so many kind of documentaries and things. A woman of great charm, humour, an inner peace. I think out of whatever lives Sellers may have disrupted or left a lot of, awkwardness in the wake, because you know with Blake Edwards there was always a love-hate thing I think happening. Anne seems to have emerged from it with a great sense of generosity and love, I would say. And then meeting her just after the Cannes screening, she's a very generous and woman who seems completely resolved in her mind that there was there were great dimensions to the marriage. I mean, there's some fabulous footage of her and Sellers goofing off together and doing funny shtick. And very devoted to the children, I think. I could sense that even though they're now grown-up, middle-aged people, they have a terrific sense of family.
Champagne, Sophia, please.
And you think Sellers is not a man to have found weak women attractive. You know, you might think that's the case with him, but actually, accidentally, he would always find very powerful women attractive. Anne is a very powerful, strong person. She's from Melbourne in Australia. She's a real down-to-earth, sort of strong, funny, witty, bright woman. And, you know, later on, if he thought he was marrying Britt Ekdon and she'd be a walkover, that was the wrong woman, too. There was not a woman who you could just walk over and someone who'd do as she told. I don't think he meant to do this, but he would find these people.
Well, I think she understood Peter and had enough, great reserves within her own personality to be able to handle this kind of man-child.
But at the same time, it was a different world, wasn't it? In those days, divorce was an absolute nightmare.
Yeah, and the poignant thing, he did have her photo in his wallet the weekend that he died. So I think there was always, and it was a substantial marriage, it must have been 16 years or so. And he always referred to her with all the other girlfriends. She said, oh, Peter would always bring over the new girlfriend and we'd talk about them. And again, here, now that he's got the wealth from the success in films, the new toys happen to be, if Sophia says, will you live too far away, well, he'll move into town.
Right.
And he can buy. He's now got the facility to be able to indulge those sort of impulses, I suppose.
I think she pointed out that we international film stars live in the heart of things. We don't live in the suburbs with the family. We live where artists and great, powerful people live. He felt like he had to be a part of it. And, of course, he accidentally, or however you want to see it, introduced her future husband.
Hell, have a drinky poo and make a night of it. Ted, whatever's fine with Anne is perfectly fine with me.
I mean, it's really hard to imagine that, but it feels like what happened, or either that's what happened, or he wanted to Anne to have an alternative so he felt better about his apparent affair with Sophia Loren, or it was a test of some type. You know, to see how much she really loved him and would she stay with him. Because, I mean, I think he always felt very insecure about women. He never felt attractive, but he never thought that women would really like him, you know. And that was the fun bits and pieces that we added at the start of this scene with, you know, of him so nervously like a schoolboy waiting for Sophia Loren to turn up for dinner. This is not a suave playboy.
What would Sir and Madam say to a little fish?
I'd probably say, hello, little fish.
I pinched this line from one of his short films that he did, where he plays...
terrible hairstyle.
Yes, he plays this mad guy in a restaurant, and the I always love the exchange where the waiter says, what would Sir say to a little fish? And he says, oh, I'd probably say, hello, little fish. I thought it was such a great little comic kind of innocence almost. There are a number, we sort of had a checklist of bits and pieces that you thought, oh, it'd be great to get that into the film in some way because it seems quintessentially his humour.
And it was great. Jeffrey would often surprise all of us with them in the scenes, which made it much better. If it had been planned, I think it would have had less, had not had the impact that it did, his bits and pieces. I think that's one of the reasons that Blake Edwards was so astonished by. He couldn't understand how Jeffrey nailed Sellers without having ever met him. And I think, you know, there are themes that run through his home movies and his films and his bits and pieces that Jeffrey was adding all these tiny bits and pieces all the way through, and lots of body language stuff that subtly really grabbed people.
I think you're mistaken. Go home to your children and go home to your wife, Peter.
Obviously, believing he loves Sophia Loren, he feels like when she tells him to go home to his wife and children, he completely misplaces that idea and goes home to discuss the terms of the separation.
Well, what do you think?
Does this mean you want a divorce?
Oh. You know, I hadn't thought of
that. I went to New York to persuade Emily to do it, and Emily was doing two plays, I think, for Sam Mendes in New York. I can't remember what the name, which ones they were now.
Twelfth Night and Uncle Vanya.
Oh, that's right. And the night before I arrived, after the shows, she had ended up going to dinner with a whole bunch of people in Soho, and it turns out one of them was Anne Levy, who was, you know, originally Anne Sellers, who was a still tremendously glamorous, very funny, late 60s or early 70s year old lady. And as I said, she took that as an omen. She didn't really speak to her properly about this until later, but and took it as some form of omen, thank heavens. And then I was able to snag her for the film.
That shot of Emily there in the loneliness of that sort of ghostly lit house, I thought was Peter, the DP, was achieved beautifully.
Hello, Ted. It's Anne Sellers.
And the way you've chopped this up to not be just a straightforward phone call, because events are very compressed here, and
right
in that we didn't really want to have Anne looking as though she was betraying their marriage, but that there was a sort of need to find some kind of solace, I suppose, from...
I think she needed to believe that this was not the way love worked, you know, that this is... There must be an alternative, a more sane alternative to what was happening in her life.
It must be very... I can't imagine for the family, because the notoriety of the whole Sellers filmography, the private life, the public life, the kind of celebrity in the 60s that now has become much more tawdry. It's been so covered. They've lived with it, really, since his death, on an extraordinary level of invasion. But, you know, I hope with this film that I certainly didn't want to approach the role... which I think would be foolhardy, with a judgment on the character to say, well, the script seems to be suggesting that he does mean-spirited or, you know, nasty things, or he has a terrible kind of personality disorders. I wanted to try and find a way of making him understandable or comprehensible. And I took it more on the line of a kind of artistic temperament, because to me the way the shape of the film works is that when his life goes off the rails, his private life, he seeks refuge in the new film projects. And the more the film goes on in the structure of it, even those film projects start to become more and more chaotic. And less satisfying, which ultimately leads to the quest to do being there. So in some ways, the writers and in Stephen's restructuring of the film in post-production to try and give it some secret chapters that don't seem too obvious, shapes him into a dramatic character who, if you take away the fact that he's famous and he's Peter Sellers and actually look at him as a husband, father, lover, son, he becomes a very intriguing figure.
Your mother is sleeping with the interior decorator.
Well, I asked Stephen at one point during the shoot, I said, you know, apart from the fact that this is a biographical picture set at a particular point in history that happens to be about the life and times of a very famous British film actor, what else is it about, Steve? And he, I can't quote exactly, but he said something like, you know how sad men can be? There's that sort of strange inner life that can go on in the male mind where there's a kind of melancholy and a stupidity and a hopefulness. And I said, don't say anymore. I know exactly what you're talking about. And we never really tried to tackle it any more deeply than that because so much of the script then became very vivid in my mind and I started to forget about being overly obsessed about recreating a look-alike, sound-alike, personification or the essence of the character or whatever, and start to play him as a dramatic figure in a very particular cinematic and history of Britain-type landscape. And I figured that's the area that you've really got to kind of zero in on. Because I can't offhand, apart from there's a wonderful young man who was in the anniversary party, the film that Jennifer Jason Leigh and Alan Cumming's made. Mm-hmm. And there's a young boy in that, and there's a running gag in that film because everyone goes up to him and says, people tell you you look like Peter Sellers. And this boy does look like Peter Sellers in his 30s. And I thought, well, you can go that way in the casting, you know. But only having a sort of identikit kind of premise to work from, you might shortchange the inner life of the character.
I'll meet you downstairs.
And I think, like a lot of us, I'm not sure if, well, certainly in my, I look back at my life as a director and I realize one of the reasons I do it, I think, is because you want life to be a certain way. If you can be a director, you can create a world. I mean, it's an old cliche, but it means you have some, you think you pretend to yourself that you have some control over your life, you know? And then you see a sequence like this, which is so powerful, where Anne leaves Sellers, even though she obviously has such strong feelings for him, but she realizes she can't be with him anymore. And things are said and things are done. He smashes up the house and says things and attacks her on a personal level. And don't you just wish sometimes after those kind of arguments you could just change it? Mm. Change what was said. And a lot of times, you know, you as a person, or I would, if after arguments, I kind of wish I hadn't said that, or I wish I had said that, that's what I really meant. But of course, in this masterful reproduction of Emily Watson by Jeffrey, it's so cleverly, the idea in the script is so clever that she comes in, you know, him as Anne Sellers comes in. But instead of redoing what he said, he restructures what she says. So he wants to hear it differently, which is also, you know, a selfish intuition that a lot of us have. You know, no one wants to hear this kind of truth about themselves. And he takes it, you know, And I think this scene expresses that beautifully. It expresses about how it was impossibly difficult for him to be told that he was hated by someone he loved. He really was so desperate to be admired and adored by people. I think that's what drove him in some ways.
And Emily, to me, is one of those great actresses who takes no easy shortcuts or indulges in any simple cliches to start building the nuances and the textures of the character. She always finds an astonishing inner truth and plays it with such subtlety and subliminal power. And I always felt it in the fact that the script asked me to play her, I would never really achieve that. I mean, we had a pretty good bash at making me look like Peter Vaughan as Bill, to the point where some people take half that monologue to realize that it's Sellers, at me as Sellers playing that character. But I knew with Anne that the strength of the idea of revoicing the scene was almost like what Sellers might have done in one of his films. Because he rarely did drag. I mean, he did the Duchess in The Mouse That Roared, and he had a wonderful character that appeared on radio and in a couple of the short Goon films called Crystal Jollybottom. And I knew that once I had the Emily lookalike wig on, it was not going to be a pretty sight. So I hope the scene works for an audience on the tension that it's a fairly shameless bit of crude music hall drag, but it's got the meat of it, which is, as Stephen was saying, if I could only revoice this horrible, painful moment of an argument I've had with my spouse and make it perfect.
Blake Edwards is shooting a David Niven movie in Rome and Switzerland. Starts filming next week, wants you. Next
time. This was all recreated in the studio by the fact, I suppose, that the hotel has changed so much in the last 40 years. But also the rooms, I don't know the penthouse suite at the Dorchester, I've never stayed in it. But you wanted that wonderful feeling of him being rattling around in a very large, sort of overwhelming, posh environment.
But an environment unlike the real Dorchester, which is quite blank, you know, because I don't think Sellers really made a home ever. You know, he would have things in his homes, but he'd never make a home. He'd never want to decorate it himself, except with crazy artwork and pieces of technology, which he loved. And now, of course, he's in the full thrall of film stardom, which Peg has told him is the only important thing in his life. And he moves on to doing The Pink Panther. Henry Goodman here is playing Dennis Selinger, who is a very, very famous agent, the agent to everybody in this country. He represented Michael Caine, Sean Connery, anybody who was anyone. He worked at William Morris. And all the people I know have seen the film, including Sarah Sellers, and everyone said that Henry nailed him. Because we have lots of footage of Dennis, who was quite a playboy and a bon vivant around town. But he was a wonderful agent with Sellers. He knew how Sellers' mind operated and could bring Sellers around to seeing things to his advantage. You know, when I think often Sellers, in a strange way, as much as he wanted to be a film star, I think he had the emotional, creative mindset of an independent filmmaker. You know, he was very satirical and very dark in his comedy. It wasn't an obvious mainstream humorist, you know. And I think, you know, Selinger became one of his guides, you know, to help him through these periods.
Excuse me, but aren't you Peter Sellers?
Not today.
We made this a sort of slightly fantasy sequence in a way that this is how, under the pressure of being called to Chinichita at very short notice, how did he come up with the Clouseau character? Is this a dream happening in his head as he's sitting there reading the script, or did it really happen? I think the lines are a little blurred. But it was also a chance to engage in some Clouseau-esque dialogue without just, again, stopping the film to pay homage with a sort of accurate excerpt from the famous films.
Well, he liked the pompousness, apparently, of the character, of the man on the matchstick boy. He was looking for pompousness and a bad Sam Spade copy, so which is why he would love to wear the raincoat.
I mean, I think originally you did shoot a bit where you see him pinching the coat from the the coat rack in the plane as though he's improvising something. But as people have pointed out to me, hardly anyone in France wears a Burberry. They don't, certainly don't wear those houndstooth hats. And that's, or, you know, and that's, and they don't really speak like that. I mean, he's completely invented a French voice that pretty much everyone I know does their own version of. You know, even my own son, who's 8, goes, it's some sort of berm, you know.
Once again, it's less about him being French and more about how pompous the British are, that if someone comes along who can't speak British properly, they won't even pay attention to him. You know, that he's an idiot. But Clouseau, like many of his characters, are very sad. Clouseau's he's a guy who's desperate to be admired for his great intellect, and he wants to save the world and solve crimes, but he's completely inept, but you'll always see him trying to pull himself together. He hates being seen as a fool. He knows he's a fool and he can't deal with it.
So this was an encapsulation, wasn't it, Stephen, really, of trying to show him as a comedian coming into the very plush, slick, intensely creative world of Blake Edwards' film studio.
Edwards was the ringmaster completely on it. Yeah, all the crews adored him. You know, everything came to him with great ease. He was handsome. He was cool. He had the most modern clothes on. And I think, you know, Sellers must have admired him greatly to have to find life that simple and easy. And he was so famous from doing Breakfast in Tiffany's. You know, he was on the top of his game. I think Sellers was, you know, so impressed by that Hollywood style that he had, apart from anything else.
Running things on a shoestring, I see.
Welcome to Hollywood.
This is Italy.
Hollywood is a state of mind.
I've got one or two ideas about this. A couple of bits of business.
Peter,
I'd like to...
the script will be shot as written.
Blake Edwards is such a powerful character in real life and such a huge character in Sellers' life. It, you know, needed someone who could really be overwhelming. And John is literally big in every way.
He exudes the most wonderful actorial energy. He would come into the makeup van pumped with enthusiasm for the project and giving me wonderful feedback, saying, Jeffrey, you look great in the outfit, and it's going to be a terrific day shooting. And it was very, very infectious because each actor would come in for, say, a two-week block just for the practicalities of that. We would shoot all the Blake scenes, and then we'd shoot all the Charlize as Brit scenes and the Emily scenes. And when John was on set, there was a kind of, what I imagine, a sort of Blake Edwards sparky, highly professional enthusiasm that came with John Lithgow.
Interesting. In this scene, you know, Jeffrey's kind of real. Well, generally, we've really recreated that one scene very closely from the Panther movie, and we even went into mono with the sound and everything. I don't know if you noticed this. You know, all the sound gets withdrawn from the studio, going into a slightly crackly mono, like the film is. And then we pull out again at the end, and we do that quite a lot in this film, of going in and out of different types of sound and stuff. This is one of the amazing special effects in this film. Very little of that was there. It was the balcony and a couple of trees. And we had this great visual effects crew, Joe Pavlo and everyone who created these. So much of the film, and I haven't had time to mention it, so much of the film is never there. This is all absolutely created. And this dialogue in this scene is directly attributable to Sellers. Again, it's a famous quote that he had about having his character, his personality surgically removed.
This is such a team effort. David Niven is one of the cinema's most distinguished leading men. One can learn a lot from people like that, you know.
Terrific, Blake. Talk tomorrow about that.
Nigel Havers plays David Niven in this film, and he always wanted to play Niven. In fact, he wants to play him in The Moon is a Balloon. He owns the rights to it. So that's why he popped in and graced us with this cameo. And he captures Niven so well, doesn't he? Oh. I mean, it's a tough call.
I'm dead fucking serious.
Peter, relax.
You're not suggesting you would.
What are you talking about?
I was bloody awful up there.
that's what you're going to get out of me, I don't think I want to repeat the experience.
You're blaming me?
It's so hard to put together Sellers and Edwards. I mean, that's a mini-series by itself, their relationship. And all we could really do is try and get a sense. Like much of the film, most of these scenes are a metaphor for relationships. You can't... You know, they had men. They had such a love-hate relationship, the two of them, and they were so brilliant together when they worked, because Edwards is an amazing director with a great sense of comedy and timing, and he's one of the great slapstick directors of all time, apart from other movies. You know, you look at most of the Panther movies, they're shot in, the scenes are done in one shot, and they're planned meticulously. It's not cheating editing and stuff. I mean, the two of them really had a sense of how to make comedy work. But then, you know, he railed against, I think, anyone who he felt was in charge, even if they wanted them to be in charge. He wanted this influence in his life.
Peter, you've got a head. You should be here.
How long has he been like this?
Since last Monday.
You didn't tell me.
I think Bill's death brought a lot of... Peg's downside as a mother to Sellers' attention when this happened. I think he realized he'd never really connected with his father and saw, I think, for the first time maybe how his motherhood really dominated his life, but not necessarily always in a great way. There was a turning point in their relationship, certainly in all the books that I've read, that after Bill died, they were never as close again. They really moved apart, and I think when they moved apart, Peg fell to pieces a little bit. She became a very isolated character.
Peter Vaughan played this... We did a... The continuity woman, I remember, sobbed during the camera rehearsal because Peter Vaughan just started the scene, even when we were just running the lines and sort of warming into where we might be positioned for camera or whatever. I found it extraordinarily moving.
My son was a special boy.
At the end of this scene, actually, it was the first time, unlike we have in the film now, as Geoffrey walks out, he becomes Peg. The first time he becomes his own mother, but we didn't have that in the film eventually. We have a different version of that later. But it just this scene became so powerful, you know, that I felt it sort of took away the really powerful emotion, the strength of the scene by kind of mocking it one too many times.
The whole set pulled apart, and you saw all the crew and whatever from the fictional behind the scenes making of the life and death of Peter Sellers, and he emerges as Peg.
But he also talks about how he dominated his son and how it was important. But we also felt that we thought we'd made that point already in the film, and we didn't need to restate that. Miriam is so great in the scene. It was so important to me that it's clear that she is deeply upset by her husband's death. But her reaction to that is to try and survive. Because that's what she's done in her whole life. When things have gone tragically wrong, she's carried on moving forward and she's dealing with things, and that's the way she worked as a mother, you know. And otherwise she's just a monster, you know, which is obviously not the case, really. She was, I think, quite a terrifyingly powerful woman. But I think in this scene she loses her husband and her son at the same time. And originally, in one version of this, this scene came much earlier in the film, didn't it? Mm. But we decided to that this his now journey into the afterlife and to try and work out what life was meant and the need to look for a new guide. He started going to psychics, and the first psychic he went to was Maurice Woodruff, played by Stephen Fry. It's interesting, physically in the film, if these actors hadn't all been very tall, like John and Stephen and Emily is very tall, and obviously Charlize is very tall. I was thinking of how to make Geoffrey look a little bit more childlike by keeping him diminutive, but we had all these huge actors, because Geoffrey's much taller than Sellers. But But apart from that, I think I always wanted to kind of feel like he was a kid around all the other actors. And so because I had these, I lucked out and happened to end up with these actors, which without thinking about that, it was he always feels like a little boy.
When I saw this cut, the juxtaposition of putting this now after Bill's death, even though we didn't play it in that particular way, but it took on a resonance of this was the grief that he actually wasn't able to express, that he was sort of taking refuge, that there was a legitimate reason, it wasn't just a sort of strange, nutty whim that he wanted to get involved in psychic activities, that there was a search going on, a very active search to try and avoid the kind of depth of emotion that he may well have felt about Bill's death.
And also he's no longer going to his mother for guidance too, he's heading off in a new direction too. He would never go to a psychiatrist. I think like a lot of people, you know, we're scared of them.
But is it not a particularly British cultural thing, is it, then?
No, you're right. But I think he didn't, once again, he just didn't understand how things worked. I think like a lot of great artists, or even I think Michael Jackson's a great artist, for instance, I think you get a sense that some of these great artists feel like their talent flows through them, but they don't know where it comes from or how to hold on to it or why people like them or why people think they're great and they're waiting for it to go away, you know? And I think sometimes it's a search to find out what's the nature of things, you know?
This scene here, the crossing of the street there, a friend of mine saw the film screened in Australia and said, oh, you must have had enormous difficulty closing down Trafalgar Square and Whitehall on early hours of a Sunday morning. I said, no, it's entirely green screen with me standing on 1X on the floor, Hopkins as director going, and action, and crossing the road, and duck away from the truck, and jump up onto the footpath, and they put everything in, including this entire car showroom scene.
It was our first day of shooting, I think, wasn't it? Proper shooting.
It was our first official day of photography.
And we were all very impressed, because we had lots of pretty girls on set. But it was all blue screen, completely fabricated from scratch. And, you know, in some ways, as a director, it's a nightmare. The first day you shoot, you're shooting completely in limbo. And obviously that sequence feels like a dream. We tried to make it like a sort of a 60s commercial for something that cleans your kitchen. Do you know what I mean? So all of a sudden you walk in and everything magically gets clean, everything magically perfect, you know? Sellers, I think, always wanted to live in a Hollywood film. And once again, it's just trying to see thing, you know, life through his eyes. One of the ideas of the film, I think it's turned out quite successfully, is that the film feels like a film Peter Sellers would have appeared in. It feels like one of the more successful films he would have appeared in with the kind of surreality and seeing life the way he would have done.
Oh, God. I don't seem to be able to get it in. What's going on? Jiggered about.
Good evening, Mr. Sellers.
Oh, Christ. You nearly gave me a heart attack.
You're a hard man to get a hold of.
Not really. Linda, I'd like you to meet Stanley Kubrick.
Director vanity, I just, when we introduced Kubrick, I thought it would be fun to have the sense of impending power. And so I, you know, kind of slightly recreated the idea of The Shining here, you know, when you see the doors, the elevator doors opening and the feet padding along the carpet and then across the wood. The set was designed with it in mind. So you could have the idea of this force coming towards him. And it was going to be dangerous.
And that they recognize each other because, yes, historically they had worked on Lolita.
Yes, it's good that you're fine and I'm fine. And I agree with you. It's great to be fine. Now then, Dimitri.
Obviously, there are lots of films we couldn't cover and lots of characters and lots of pieces. But the thing I think Strange Love was such an important film in lots of ways, and not only for his career, but also, once again, he goes up, He's already worked with Kubrick in Lolita and done a brilliant film with him. But that film was, strangely enough, banned in England, which you would never think sort of a film about sexuality would be, because it seems to be the antithesis of that, and run in only a few art house films in America. And even though it was, you know, people thought it was a masterpiece in lots of ways, it was never really seen very much in those days. It was only later on that it was seen as a cult movie. Kubrick obviously understood Sellers very clearly. I have tapes of him talking about Sellers and how it worked. And we have actually footage of him playing tennis with Stanley Kubrick in some of his home movies, that's bizarre. And a lot of people think of Kubrick as probably a cold person, and it seems that it's not the way the case at all. He was a very bright person who really cared about people, and I think his films have very strong characters in. But in the way that Sellers was, he would work with Kubrick at the height of both their careers, and once again he would fight with Kubrick. He looked up to him so much, because he looked up to him so much, he would want to overcome him. As much as that same feeling inside him. He needed a leader, but he wanted to destroy them at the same time. And I think this was a point in his life because he was adrift emotionally. He had no strong relationship with one woman. He seemed to be becoming more and more isolated as a film star. And then to play all these roles in one film, I think this really took him to a next level of being isolated as a person, I think.
But it's what you said in some interviews too, Stephen, about on paper, characters like Lionel Mandrake or Strangelove himself or Merkin Muffley shouldn't really exist, because they are almost like radio goon show characters that you can imagine in your mind. I mean, Lionel Mandrake is the definitive stiff upper lip Britishman, and Strangelove is, to me, they're like Alice in Wonderland characters. They are so surreal, because Strangelove is made up of the rocket scientist, the sort of sexual deviant, and he happens to be dressed in a Beatles suit. I mean, it's the height of hip fashion from the 60s, with those alarmingly tinted glasses that make his eyes look like onyx. He looks like the devil behind them. And yet somehow Sellers' gifts allows you to totally enter into those three very, very distinctive worlds. I mean, Merkin Muffley must be the grayest, blandest, most intensely sort of Washington-speak, non-event president that you could ever imagine. And yet Sellers makes him completely fascinating to watch.
How was lunch with your son, Mrs. Sellers?
I don't know, really. I didn't see him.
Kubrick realized that Sellers usually only had one fabulous take in him, which was usually the first take. And if you look at Strangelove or a lot of Blake Edwards films, you'll see how difficult he was to film, because no one knew what he would do. They would spend a lot of time working out. Sellers would walk around the set all day and find props and talk about things, and they'd plan a few bits and pieces of sort of where he should be, but then he would come out and do whatever. And Kubrick was shot with three cameras, because he realized that you had to get the first one in. The second one would never be as great, and the third one, you might as well forget.
And to match things.
Yes. I mean, no one knew he was going to do the Hitler impersonation. That was all first time on shot, and he never mentioned it until he did it. I'm not sure how much Sellers planned or didn't plan. I suspect he did to some extent.
It's quite a famous bit in the mid-shot where he, in the chair, in the wheelchair, really remonstrates against his dead arm and is sort of banging it and hitting it and doing all sorts of things on the wheel. Peter Bull, who plays the Russian ambassador, quite openly just cracks up in the background of the shot.
A lot of actors do, but you can see Bull.
They must have just gone with it because it was such a gem.
But you notice how badly it's cut. Suddenly you cut to this angle that you wouldn't understand where you would cut to, because Kubrick had to cut around to stop, because everyone would start laughing their heads off during the scene, which was, of course, unacceptable in this movie. And later on, Blake Edwards would overlight his set enormously, because they never knew where Sellers was going to go to, even. You know, and they would shoot with, once again, with multiple cameras just in case that he did something that no one was prepared for, you know. But and in that tape I heard of Kubrick speaking, it's very much about that. He knew that they would, they had worked out that his arm had been withered from some radioactive experiment, but it was that's all they'd really discussed. Well, they obviously discussed a lot of things, but they hadn't discussed the fact that he would be openly hiding his Nazism on camera by going into Hitler mode. And so sort of, there are probably, who are the actors who do that nowadays? There are probably people like Jim Carrey, you think, right? Probably who would have to get filmed with multiple cameras or something, because you're not really sure how they're going to be. But I think, like you say, the thing about Sellers is you just accept it. You accept that character completely. You're not laughing at how silly the character is. You're laughing at the film with him as a part of it.
And again, I suppose, with this scene with Merck and Muffley, rather than it just being an affectionate look on a day of the filming or a recreation, even though I think Peter Levy's lit it, it's been designed extraordinarily well, it's you get the value of that pretty bizarre and hilarious phone conversation that he's having with Dimitri, who's obviously drunk and having an orgy down at the other, somewhere in the Kremlin or whatever. But it is, Stephen seems to subliminally drop in the shots. It's more about the kind of rigorous intellect and playfulness that Kubrick's got, and he can sense that he's got a very volatile and magnificent performer to work with, and that they're sort of jostling in a kind of creative chess game of who's actually in charge of the set. So, if I can use a kind of Broadway analogy, it's like you don't just have a song to stop the show and entertain people. You push the ideas or the drama or the story that little bit further forward, and that's what the aim was with those kind of sequences.
What do you want?
That scene in the bathroom too was the one time we had a glitch, because one angle setup came back from the lab damaged or bleached or something. So it was a tricky one, because about 3 weeks later we had to reschedule it and just shoot that angle again and try and match, which was, I suppose, a sort of difficult scene emotionally, because of working with James as Michael, and who was, again, astonishing in his psychiatric pastoral care that he gives his father. It turns it into quite a beautiful scene, I think.
I think working with kids, I find, is very interesting, and it relates to Sellers too. I find that working with children, if they've got an emotional scene coming up, you'll go and chat to the mum, you'll chat to the kid, and they'll come in, they'll cry their eyes out, do whatever, and they'll go back to playing and homework, because it's not, you know, I think as Jeffy said one day, he likes to pull a nose hair out or something, you know, whatever. But it's like, or you have to think of something very difficult or very sad, and it's so difficult as an adult, you know. But I think that's one of the reasons why Sellers was able to do this stuff so well. I think he had the emotional sense of a child, and so he could go in any direction and do anything. He wasn't restricted by the baggage of being an adult.
Fred, I had a spot of bother getting out of a cab last night.
Jeffrey, I remember he came up with a brilliant idea for this, because it was hard to work out why Sellers refused to play this pilot. And I, in my mind, I wasn't sure if it was a part of his rebellion or what it was, but he recognized, I think, there's a point where he thought it would just have been boring for Sellers to be stuck in this thing.
He sits in a cockpit, and so we added the line of, you know, what can I do? I can look out the window. And I felt that he might have, by comic instincts, that there wasn't enough there to mess around with. But it could have been an obstinate streak that he wanted to mess with Stanley.
I think you're right, though. I think for most of the film, that character's reciting lists. At the end, of course, he comes alive, but...
And a happy outcome, because Slim Pickens riding that bomb is one of the great moments of all cinema, I think. And it's a film that has become more haunting and more prescient, I think, on its 40th anniversary.
I think when Jeffrey becomes Kubrick, the speech that he gives there is really one of the more important insights into Sellers. It's coming from the point of view of someone who knew him and worked with him very well, and who was very smart at understanding actors and understanding psyches, you know, and clearly happy to investigate dark ideas and characteristics in his films. So he kind of nails it. It's often when Jeffrey became the characters in the middle of scenes that in the film, I would try and let the camera linger on him for a moment before speaking, just to give the audience a chance to realize, oh, it's Peter Sellers as Kubrick. Because some of the transformations were, you know, both by Jeffrey and by the makeup and wardrobe was so cleverly, you know, portrayed that I was scared that by the time they'd start speaking, you'd realize and it'd be too late to take in the information.
So, say with me, B-E. 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 B-E.
I think Woodruff was interesting. He was a charlatan, but he was also, once again, a very useful guide. Not only did he help, you know, film studios, and Dennis Selinger would use him to try and talk sense to Sellers, to make him make the right choices instead of mad choices, the wrong choices. And Levy and Sellers used to call up Woodruff occasionally and say, look, Peter's having a really hard time, can you help him? And so he became this guide.
He did function in a kind of... I mean, he was a very early form of... he created a niche celebrity job for himself. Because mm-hmm. I think he ran a column in, what, the Evening Standard?
The Daily Mirror, I think.
Daily Mirror.
Yeah.
But he had the sideline of looking after the stars. Yeah. And in some ways he was probably quite a good...
I read his book, actually, one of his books, and
Therapy Alternative.
He based his stuff on scientific fact about eye movement and all this kind of stuff, and it was really quite scientific and clever. Bert Quick told me a great story. Bert Quick, who plays Cato in the films, he said he was at a party for after Shot of the Dark and met Maurice Woodruff. And Maurice Woodruff was, all the stars were going to him for little readings in the corner, and Bert went up to him and said, you know, I'd like a reading. And he took a long look at Bert and he said, you don't need me, do you? You know exactly what's going on. And Bert walked away and he felt so flattered. He went, oh my gosh, I'm really in charge of my destiny. And he said, oh, he didn't know who I was. And so he was unable to read his fortune or his career.
I like sweets. Mashed. It's not unusual.
Hello. I'm Peter. Peter Sellers. Like you, I didn't have much on this evening, and I wanted to know if you'd like to go and see a movie.
Once again, it's interesting in this little sequence here to see Sellers waking up from one of his depressions and how quickly he could turn into something else. He wanted to be a combination, I think, of Tom Jones and Sean Connery, don't you think? Mm. The sexiest man on earth. But of course, when it comes to it, he kind of chickens out. And I think that's always what saves, one of the things that saves him for me. He has no confidence. He's like all us nerds in the world who really can't do what he does. You know, he has the ability to turn it on for the most beautiful woman in the world. And try as we may want to, most of us can't.
I think I'm in love with you.
But you've just met me.
Then it's still fresh in my mind.
And she was only, I think, 21, wasn't she? I think she was 21. And phenomenally beautiful.
She had just, I think, just arrived from Sweden and was well known in the modeling world, I gather. Or was this a debut, this kind of London visit?
Modeling world, and she was going to come and do this film with Richard Attenborough. The Guns of something or other, some British war movie. She was going to play a nurse or something. But literally, he saw her in a picture of the Daily Mirror and made the B.E. mistake.
That is good.
Thanks. Must take up photography as full-time job.
I need to get in closer. Come the full length. Come the full length. Yeah. Mind if I sit here? Oh, God, I haven't felt leather like this on my thighs since the Third Reich.
This is actually taken from some of his home movies again, and that is the costume that she was wearing when he was filming her. There's this great home movie stuff of him shooting her around and around the room. And this is the first scene we shot with Charlize, which is...
And you had cameras going. Well, the setups, I remember, were very quick to kind of get some sort of collage continuity to it, and I think I shamelessly threw in every stray Sellers line that I couldn't get in about... I haven't felt leather like this on my thighs since the Third Reich.
I love that line. And, of course, because Charlize wasn't scripted, Charlize wasn't expecting it, and it worked brilliantly.
It was basically, yeah, being our first day, it was just a way of having great fun with her, and she was fantastic, though. She came in so kind of mentally prepped for it. And
she just finished Monster about 10 weeks beforehand, had lost a bunch of weight, gone and done Head in the Clouds in Montreal, and then flew straight into this, and she was telling me about Monster, which, you know, sounded interesting to me, and I thought she has a lot of guts to have produced and put this film together, but obviously I had no idea what it was at the time. Now, this whole proposal sequence, having gone back to ask Anne, of course, for the permission to marry her, this is something we really improvised. You know, originally in the script, I think, there was a band playing a song in the park, I think, and he set it up. It's not how it really happened in life. In real life, he called her on the telephone from New York, which I thought was... She was in New York. He was in New York and she was in London, and that, which I thought was perfect. I don't think he had the guts to... He thought no one like her would ever marry him. And he sent her fabulous gifts and flew her to Paris for dinner and all this kind of stuff. But this sequence, we thought, encapsulated once again his insecurity with women. The only way he could possibly propose to a woman of this great beauty and...
Well, it's a prototype Bond moment, isn't it? I mean, he's sort of fantasizing the proposal as being, I'm in... a very stylish, slick Cary Grant-type film at the moment. And I tried to feel as though I was, for myself, having a Rat Pack kind of moment on this day of shooting, because I don't get to do that anyway. So it was a dream come true.
None of this sequence was choreographed, because Jeffrey and I rarely had a chance to rehearse anything, so it's remarkable that it comes across like it does. It was all shot in a matter of a few hours.
I actually do dance like that at parties.
Yes.
That wall grab with the leg going up and the Nijinsky moment are well known in lounge rooms in Melbourne.
It's a homage to Liza Minnelli, who Sellers was later engaged to, I think.
Yes, I remember when we were shooting that scene, I said, do you think people are going to... understand that this is what English men are really like. We were finding it hard to find any butch moments, maybe.
Right.
And Lance Allington, who you don't get in this cut, you don't get as much of a glimpse of him in the goon sequence at the beginning,
right.
But he's the son of Ray Allington, who was the guy that, you know,
the singer and the bandmaster and the drummer on the Goon.
On the Goon Show.
And a lifelong friend of Sellers, too.
I love you, Peter!
You hear that, folks? She loves me.
That the marriage, actually, that footage that of I love you, Peter, and stuff, that was taken directly from his home movies again with Charlize and... with obviously Sellers and Britt were absolutely plastered on their wedding. And doing the best thing. I mean, it was a huge celebrity wedding. They were like Beckham and Posh, you know, in those days.
So, Peg, what do you think of the new cottage?
You're watering the gin.
Well, in your case, perhaps that's not a bad idea.
People don't realise how incredibly famous Sellers was. I didn't realise that he was one of the highest paid film stars of all time in the 60s. He was one of the first men to get paid $1 million for a film. People would get given a Rolls Royce to read a script.
And when you look, I mean, Christopher Marcus and Steve McFeely, the writers, have chosen an obvious sort of dramatic high point in this story of his life, which is the first series of heart attacks in 64, which do occur at an extraordinary time in his life where he has Oscar nominations, he's got a highly popular Hollywood career started, failure of a first marriage and marrying Brit. And post-heart attack, you do get a feeling of the kinds of films he did. I mean, some of my personal favourites are things like What's New Pussycat, because I think Fritz Fassbinder is just one of the great screen creations. But there were a lot of films then for the next 8 or 9 years that were, certainly by my taste, not as highly regarded as some of the masterpieces. But as somebody pointed out, his popularity never really waned because the great films like I'm All Right, Jack and Strangelove, etc., were always shown on TV. He was still a celebrated figure, I think, in the public eye because of the marriage to Miranda Quarry, which must have been a very short
relationship. It was only a matter of weeks, I think.
Yeah.
He was engaged to Liza Minnelli for 2 weeks.
In 69 or so. And he was making all of those groovy films like Casino Royale and Magic Christian and, you know.
He did The Party.
The Party was
not a success at all.
When
it came out, it was a real failure at the box office and became a cult.
Interestingly enough, that's the one film, if you speak to people under 40 who didn't grow up in the era when he was making movies, that's the one film that they've all cottoned onto as an absolute kind of...
Yeah, we had to get the Birdie Num Num reference in on during his LSD sequence, which is in the movie. It's going to be fine. Please.
He's arrested. Okay, let's charge to 120.
Yeah, in one night he had 8 heart attacks.
And originally this scene, from the lovemaking in L.A. through to the heart attack, used to start the film as scripted. And I would then transform Ocellus into the doctor, who would then talk to the camera.
I would walk off the film set talking about the making of the film.
But it was too many ideas too soon, I think. And the happy accident was that the Bill monologue at the beginning of the film then became a much more interesting and acceptable use of the technique. And it also, with an early audience of friends and colleagues who saw it, they felt that when it got back to that sequence, that the film was about to end. So it was a creative decision that Stephen made in shaping the material in post-production to find what was there, I suppose, because there were so many sequences and things.
Yeah, I think it did two things, that sequence. It made you feel there was something plastic about the film too early on, so it was harder to get into the characters. But Jeffrey's right, the real problem was that when you got to the sequence, they thought, oh, that's the end of the film, because it's about an hour and a quarter into the film, and which is disastrous for when you think the film's ending and it's got another 45 minutes to go. So we decided, we rethought the framing device and started off with Jeffrey walking to the studio and ended him at the end, walking out of the film studio, the film having been made, which is more conventional, but there's so many non-conventions in this film, it was fine, I think.
And again, the technique the writers came up with, which... and Stephen showed me a rough assembly of this dream sequence, what's going on inside Sellers' head, maybe a week or two after we'd shot it. And I was just dazzled that he'd taken the Kubrick idea of Planet Sellers and using the Blue Danube, which none of which was scripted as such, because playing all of these characters in this scene, we actually had to shoot them individually prior to principal photography starting, because it was the only way we could timetable in these elaborate makeups. So they were basically the days we did the makeup tests for Clouseau and for the Duchess, et cetera, because there was no way we were ever going to have a timetable capability of achieving it. And in some of these wider shots, not so much them, the aerial shot that comes up, there were 10 mimes who came in and
who'd already seen the footage and was
seen the footage
and planned to copy Jeffrey's movements. Yeah, I think when people look at the script, and this was around for years, people didn't know quite. They were scared that you'd never be able to attach yourself to Sellers because there was, and it was always, you know, it was always the thing we had to be careful of to make sure that it never became just a glossy bunch of silly, you know, sort of episodic vaudeville type sequence of events. But I think because the theme of who he is runs clearly through it, I think that takes care of that.
I think also in the storytelling, it is the miracle of surviving the heart attacks gives him a bizarre new strength.
Right.
And it's also a way of demolishing, as he often chose to do, the work that he'd already done. If these characters were starting to kind of overcrowd his psyche, it was a great way of cleaning himself out and saying, I'm now going to be me, I'm going to find out who I am, I'm going to be James Bond.
But he also made this gigantic mistake, I think, of thinking, okay, I have to be, my life is limited. There's mortality to I'm going to die at some point. So a lot of people would slow down and reevaluate themselves, and Sellers sped up. Much like that idea that if you're running out of petrol, if you go faster, you'll get there before you run out of petrol. And he just crammed his life with stuff. It was just amazing. You know, he was one of the original jet set. There weren't jet setters then. There was him and Polanski and Jack Nicholson and whatever. There was just a few people who began this lifestyle.
Polanski, maybe.
Yeah.
Elizabeth Taylor, Richard Burton. They were kind of very big, powerful figures in that kind of lifestyle, I suppose.
And in this, and what comes now is this wonderful sense of Sellers trying to play himself in something. He decided, like Cary, apparently, he thought Cary Grant just played himself on screen, which of course he didn't. You know, he thought that these people who moved lithely and effortlessly through these films as heroes, they were like that in real life. And he decided to join that echelon. But it was a disastrous experience for everyone involved, I think, because he really saw himself very clearly that he was not these people. And he was. It took great effort to try and find himself to be Bond.
Who are you? How did you get past my guards?
Good evening, darling. My name is Bond. James Bond.
But again, you're taking him into a sort of, I suppose, the way Sellers is imagining the film that he's in, because that scene doesn't actually sort of technically exist in Casino Royale, but you get a... Norman Garwood has given us a quintessential hip, you know, 1967 sense of decor and...
But yeah, and also you had to try and, when you went through the script, as famous as Orson Welles is, are you making that for the sake of filmophiles? Is it really showing about Sellers? Or is it, you know, he had a tremendous fear of Welles, he felt he was a magician of some type, and maybe terrifying on the scale of being this giant film icon, you know?
Good evening, darling. My name's Bond. James Bond.
It was actually written in the script, and it was simply we got to a point where we had to cut the script down because the film got far too expensive. We had a scene with two scenes with Welles, which would have been great, but we thought, you know, you have to find out the essence of some things. You know, the film would have been 4 hours long. We do have Heidi Klum as Ursula Andress. That's almost as good, I think, don't you?
There's a little bit here that I always wanted to be in, but he walks over and fires all the blanks in his gun into the director and the camera crew.
We shot it, and then I found that the next scene, unfortunately, was kind of a repetition in terms of revenge on that, and I tried to cut it into this sequence to see if I could make it work, but it just seemed too anarchic, and I mean, in the end, it was going to end up as either one scene or the other.
Well, the film, there's a slight sort of deception here, because you'd like to think that he's filming the James Bond film, but in fact, in the style of that, he's...
And once again, this is a metaphor.
Being James Bond, aborting the whole project.
In reality, Sellers drove around Pinewood, which is very wooded like this, round and round and round all day, because he wouldn't go into set. And every now and then he'd get his driver to stop and call in and say he couldn't come in today because astrologically it was the wrong day to come in. So, and this gentleman here is based on his longtime compatriot Joe McGrath, who he did many films with, but unfortunately he did a TV variety thing with Joe and liked him, but he'd keep on hiring him for films and then firing him. And also on Magic Christian too, but they stayed friends for most of his life.
And all those tight shots, of course, because I can't drive at all, they were all green screen studio mixed in with aerial footage of the car chase.
This is a combination of scenes, right? Originally, I think this scene was just a scene by himself eating the newspaper, and then there'd be another scene at breakfast where he'd have this conversation with Britt. But I thought the domestic quality of this... You know, there's a big sense of difference. You watch the movie, the pieces that are parts of films feel much more glamorous and actually are sometimes less handheld. And then when we come into this stuff, it's more kitchen sink. You know, it's a very nice kitchen sink that he has, but it's more, it feels more like this faux documentary style, you know, on a light level, that you feel like you're in the bathroom with them. And most people who have been in couples have had a conversation in this kind of environment, and it just felt that even though the conversation itself is bizarre, that it's an environment that's possible for most people without the gold taps.
Oh, wow.
Of course, in those days, you know, the pill had become, you know, the contraception had become a new exciting thing in the 60s as part of the sexual revolution. And so we were very careful in this scene too. You know, this scene could seem very cruel, you know, purposely cruel, but it wasn't meant to be on any level. It was meant to be, you know, there's no reason. She's Brit Mayer. He may think, hey, the abortion's a new thing. We can do that. We can prevent having a child if we don't want one. But Brit really wanted to have a child. She'd been around with him for years now and really felt that it was the time to do it, I think.
They met, I think they married after 3 weeks of knowing each other. It might have even been 11 days. And Peg always referred to Brit as that bleeding Nazi.
64 they were married, right?
Yeah. And this would have all been around the time of having shot The Pink Panther and probably having shot Strangelove. And right on the cusp of when he would have been traveling to America to do publicity for the Oscar nomination.
Also, he went to do the film with Billy Wilder, because he had his heart attack during the Billy Wilder film, which was never finished.
Yes, called Kiss Me Deadly? Kiss Me Stupid, sorry, yeah. I'm thinking of the Robert Aldridge film. And surprisingly enough, I gather that Billy Wilder and Sellers didn't get on at all. I find that a curious fact, because I would have thought that they...
Well, I think Wilder wrote his own scripts and would like the actors to have spoken the words in the order that he wrote them, and I think Sellers wanted to improvise. And
yes.
And he fell out with a lot of great directors that he really admired, you know, Vittorio De Sica and all these great directors he always wanted to work with, and then... Only a certain type of director could deal with Sellers, I think. Knowing, as we spoke about, that he had one great take in him and the script had to be a starting point. That, you know, obviously for some scripts and some directors that doesn't work.
Get the hell off the set.
It's interesting, after marrying Britt and really being quite a jealous man, and once again going back to the idea that he never felt that women really would like him because he wasn't attractive, or he was dull, he'd carried on to making two films with Britt Eklund straight away, both of which where he was playing a character who was jealous of her. In After the Fox, he plays, actually, it's her brother, I think, in After the Fox, and his sister is wants to be a film star, and he's in jail, and he breaks out of jail, and he does everything he can to stop her throwing herself at film producers and becoming a whore in his mind. And then again in... what's the blue face one?
The Bobo.
In The Bobo, is the same thing. He's very, very jealous of his beautiful wife in that racing around. And so he was making films that exposed himself. And when he saw them, he hated them because he didn't realize that's what he was doing, you know? But that's the material he got attracted towards. That's a look, isn't it?
I think just using it in this rather painful moment of... This is where the motif of I love you, Peter, and I love you, Peg. Hopefully the audience remembers that little shared chant that they have. But it's not forthcoming, and the kind of emotional gulf between them just seems more strange and dislocated by the fact that he happens to be dressed as a blue matador, claiming that it's his celebrity that's keeping him from her. We did toy with moments of Sellers having an open rapport with the camera. There are a lot of outtakes of me at the ends of scenes looking at the camera, almost assessing how is the audience judging me at this point, or have I been naughty, have I been good, what would you have done in this situation? And one of the few that Stephen left in, which I think is strong, is this moment of guilt that he experiences here, that he's quite lost, and it's a fairly bewildering beat, given that he's just about to become Peg, and be able to justify on her terms that this was a good thing for Peter to do, because he was achieving and he was doing what a hard-working music hall artiste should be doing, sacrificing family for his success as an artist.
But it's interesting, after him trying to be himself in Casino Royale, we come back to him playing these very large characters, even within the film, which show that, you know, it was impossible for him to really be happy in that situation.
You think he was cruel to me? Of course he was. That just means that he'd learned his lesson.
I was walking very low. Remember, I wanted to be Miriam's height.
He's like tottering along his little high heels. And we made everyone else feel a bit taller again. We made the set higher and bigger. Actually, it wasn't the set. It was the Freemasons' place in London, wasn't it?
Miriam directed me. She was absolutely fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of, she helped me interpret Peg as if she had played the scene, and what would be the words that would be most emphatic for her,
and really the accent too, and too
why things were chosen in Peg's mind to, you know, be stated on her deathbed, as it were, and that it was all quite chirpy and matter of fact, you know. She said, well, this is why, you know, she just talked out loud as if she would have played the role herself.
I mean, this wonderful Sellers double who actually appears as the technician in the earlier scene when he becomes Anne. So we were able to make these simple cuts. At one point people were talking about, let's morph Jeffrey into this and that. I said, no, let's just do it like a Sellers film, just a very simple cut from the back of one actor to Jeffrey. This is a very painful sequence around here, I think.
I love Edward Tudor Pohl and Steve in this because they provide a kind of link of the goons being there at very crucial points.
I think Britt and Sellers were together the whole time for, I think, 4.5 years.
Yeah, 64 to 68. Anne was born in England, I think, I believe. She went to Australia as a war child. I think she was sent out to boarding school in Melbourne. coincidentally enough, the same school that my daughter happens to go to. We enjoyed that conversation when we had lunch together because I'd heard that somewhere and she confirmed the story for me. And she and Sellers, I think, married in 1949 and the marriage lasted 14 years.
When he proposed to Anne, he got her to agree to marry him by locking her in a closet and not letting her out until she said yes. So that's actually one of the reasons.
But in the nicest way possible.
It's one of the reasons we put that little closet thing in the bedroom, actually.
Stop it, Peter. Christ, woman, can't you say anything real? First of all, you can't act, and then you can't stop.
You
just shut up!
You know, often in life, people take out stuff on the people they love the most. But once again, you know, Sellers took it to an extreme. And if you read Britt's book or talk to her, you know that, and or talk to people around her, you know that she gave as good as she got from him, and they would fight physically and mentally, and she was such a challenge for him. This actually happened. In fact, I have a friend who was there in the same building when it did.
Fuck you, Peter! Fuck you and your mum!
I think losing this great love of his life made Sellers go into a period of isolation for 2 or 3 years where he really lost himself, I think. Sounds like another cliche, but I don't know how else to put it.
Ground control to Major Tom.
Yeah, we're going to a sequence now in the late 60s where, you know, we thought the ideas in the world were Fellini or, you know, or The Party or The Beatles or The Yellow Submarine, where the visual metaphors that existed then became much more esoteric, I think. I have to say one thing about how incredibly excited I was to get a David Bowie song, Space Oddity, in this film. It was such a wonderful song for that time, late 60s, early 70s, because the period that's covered by that sort of bizarre short sequence is probably, what, 68 through to 72, isn't it?
Yes, and it is a song that really captures some weird sense of alienation or being isolated. And
dislocation because of celebrity.
You can't help yourself. And this sequence was much longer in the script and that it went into him journeying back in his mind to his childhood to see Peg's music hall act, which she was a projectionist artiste where she would have, you know, various, you know, she'd do famous statues or famous women and that they would be projected onto her. And so somehow in post-production it evolved, didn't it, really, into a...
Well, there was a whole... And then, of course, we went into a sequence where the...
Well, the film stopped because I played... There was a scene where I played the marketing... the American marketing manager of the movie and the development producer. And with split screen, I had a conversation between myself whether they were arguing that the marketing people were saying that the character was looking a little unlikable. Could we, you know, make him more audience-friendly? And the development guy's going, oh, these things happened, and this is what the research has shown. And
we saw a sequence where we said, let's not even mention the third wife, that's boring. And we saw a sequence where we saw Sellers throwing her poodle out the window.
They wanted to take the drugs. The marketing guy's going, can we kill the drug references? Can we? So there was a sort of, not in joke, but there was a sense of the film as scripted, feeling as though it was reaching a point where it was commenting on itself from all of those other devices of Sellers playing other characters, etc., and the dream sequences and the fantasy sequences.
And they're really different from the others.
It's a satire of Hollywood at its most, cliched and acceptable, I suppose, if you were to call it that.
It does exist, though, in its entirety somewhere.
Of how a film, is this film becoming too uncomfortable? Is it deconstructing a famous clown and a great icon too much for public taste? It was a beautifully written bit of dialectic, I think. Hollywood sort of... Can you say Hollywood dialectic? I don't think... That's like military intelligence, isn't it?
It was structurally really correct, wasn't it?
Yeah. But ultimately, when the last third of the film became the quest for some kind of artistic satisfaction in achieving being there, became the most satisfying dramatic climax to the fairly sprawling episodic life, particularly after the heart attack, a lot of that material went because it was not really taking us anywhere new. It was turning the film, I think, into a sort of whistle-stop tour of the highlights of Sellers' life rather than what really happened with the Blake-Sellers relationship and what happened with Sellers isolating himself more and more into the world of Chance the Gardener.
And then, of course, it's back to the Pink Panther.
Clouseau was originally supposed to be played by Peter Ustinov, and for whatever reason, he dropped out or withdrew from the project. I'm sure Roger Lewis has... I can't remember the facts of that. I'm sure it's detailed in the book or in Mr. Strangelove. And Sellers, I think, was probably a bit miffed, as reflected in the screenplay, that he was being asked at very short notice, but he let Dennis Sellinger, I think, talk him into it. That was part of the technique, really, wasn't it?
I don't know why Ustinov didn't do the film. Peter, are you in there? I'm not sure if Ustinov felt that it was a role that he... that's what I've heard on one hand, that Ustinov, when he came back with it, he was signed to do it, and he felt that he didn't really understand the role. I think he wanted to play something he saw as more serious, but, you know, like, he ended up playing Poirot, of course, in all those Agatha Christie things. But it was only, a week before shooting. And as it was written, it was not how Sellers played it. Ah, Jeffrey playing John Lithgow. Playing Blake Edwards.
You know who's not difficult? Troy Donahue.
I think this line about, you know who's trouble? Troy Donahue.
Yes.
I think might be a Jerry Lewis.
Right.
Attributed quote. But I like that scene with the old Swedish sea dog because it's one of his most outrageous and preposterous characters where Clouseau believes he's very cleverly and brilliantly disguised. And the fact that the writers chose to make that the costume, that he has another series of, bad kind of heart problems, and the fact that Sellers can use the comedy of the puff-up bird as a way of enjoying putting one over on Blake kind of really cements the relationship because, Blake and Sellers together as screen time, there's so many characters in the film. It doesn't add up to a lot. And we shot this one down at the Tooting Broadway, which is now a
bingo
hall. And it was a very memorable day in the filming because the female reporter that interviews Blake just at the beginning of the scene is Jane Milligan, Spike's daughter. And she was our first real contact in some ways with the people that were very close to the characters we were portraying. And for her seeing me in this period of Sellers' life, she remembered it so vividly as a teenager. And she was very sweet and kind to Edward playing Spike because she said, "You're not like my father, but you're capturing him beautifully." So it was, it was just good to get that sort of encouragement and endorsement.
I watched Jane staring at you and Edward chatting between takes at one point. She was just focused like a laser beam, just watching, because obviously this is the era that she remembers as a kid.
But again, I know when I had lunch with Michael, he was upset that that, you know, certain factual details had been shifted around and juxtaposed or invented or whatever. But I think in terms of dramatically portraying a complex relationship like Blake and Sellers had, as writers, I think with that premiere, that sort of horrible public loaded, you don't know whether Sellers is being satirical and funny and then it just goes a little too far over the line. For a three-minute scene, I think it really creates good drama.
This never happened. I mean, it happened, they had public spats at these kind of events over the years, but if you look back at them, they're quick and ferocious and out, and I think this scene is supposed to be more really, once again, a metaphor, because he sees Blake getting all the credit for this. And they fought for a long time about who was the creator of Clouseau. In fact, at one point towards the end of his life, Sellers was going to make the Romance of the Pink Panther without Blake. He actually sort of, the studios wanted him to be Clouseau rather than, even more than they wanted Blake to direct it, which is such a difficult thing. It's interesting, when Sellers watches his home movies here, his life looks so great, you know? And you watch all these bits and pieces with the horse and the kid and him with Anne and how in love they were. And there's when he's watching it, I think he's going, what's the fuss? Look, I had a great time. I don't know why everyone, you know, what happened to all my friends and why doesn't anyone like me anymore, you know, in simple terms. But I think in some ways that's, once again, the way he designed it. You know, it's much easier for him to look at life and film or through a camera than to be intimate with it.
Please leave your message after the series of tones.
Oh, hi, Dad. It's me, Mike. I tried you on the boat, but...
Spike Milligan had a great quote. This was in some interview in explaining Sellers' passion for gadgets. He said, you know, we used to love speeding up our cameras and slowing them down and playing with the form. He said, but of course, I had an 8mm camera. Of course, Peter, being the gadget freak that he was, had the state-of-the-art 16mm camera. He said he was, of course, wealthier than I. He was richer by 8mm. And again, this scene is... Sellers, throughout this phase of his life, still found a great emotional connection and a sense of a great resource in Anne, his first wife.
I think the being there thing was in the script, but it was something that I had really latched onto because I wanted to push through this last third of the film, or last quarter of the film, which is why in the end other things got dropped out, like the very important figures like Lynn Frederick and stuff. I just felt like it was one of the only things that he chased for 7 or 8 years and didn't try to destroy. He called himself Chauncey Gardner. He had cards made out, business cards. He pestered Jerzy Kosinski. And ended up making a brilliant film with one of the great film directors of all time, Hal Ashby. I mean, so it's actually a success story for once. They tried to make the film over and over again many times with lots of different directors, and it wouldn't work, and no one really wanted to make it. You know, people didn't see why it would be funny, or even though the book was a best-selling novella. Hal Ashby, even though he was at the end of his career and sort of had made some of the best films for me of all time, but he was considered a bit of a risk too, because, you know, we were leaving the worlds of the great artistic 60s and 70s of American filmmaking and entering the blockbuster world, you know, where he was obsolete. So the two of these guys together, Hal Ashby was such a gentle director, I think, and he made lots of films where the main character was someone you shouldn't have been sympathetic to. You shouldn't have been sympathetic to Warren Beatty in Shampoo or John Voight in Coming Home, or look at Harold and Maude. I mean, it's these things are characters that shouldn't be the heroes of movies, but which is why I love his films, you know. So the combination of the two of them, he understood actors really well, he was gentle, he wasn't mean, and I think he left Sellers alone to do what he was and has left Sellers to do what he wanted to do. I think during the film, if you talk to people, as much as Sellers enjoyed making it, he really didn't come out of character. You know, which is why he was so upset at the end of being there when they showed the outtakes at the end of the film, you know, where he was cracking up while he was trying to do that hilarious speech, you know.
Yes.
Because he was just, he thought it blew the Oscar and he thought it blew the magic of the film and, you know, and to some extent it's interesting you, he's not wrong, you know, as funny as those scenes are, maybe you don't want to see him not being Chance at the end of the film. Maybe you want to enjoy the fullness of that. And it, once again, it wasn't in the script, but as we were filming and stuff, I got this, I just felt that that it was sort of about his dad. It's doing this full circle and coming back to playing someone who was so the other side of him, you know, this very quiet, shy, gentle side who he would always would love to be loved for, you know.
Michael himself said that if you want to see the good side of Dad, you see it in Chance, the character of Chance.
Mm-hmm. He got a chance to do something which wasn't huge, which wasn't explosive, which wasn't, you know, which wasn't involved in gimmickry or sight gags or clumsiness or great pratfalls. It was quite daring for him, I think, to play nothing.
You're always gonna be a little boy, ain't you? Bye, Chance.
Bye, Louise.
We shot a lot more scenes of this too. We shot the whole TV show scene, remember?
The interview.
Which preceded this, which would be in the deleted scenes. But once again, it felt... Originally, the Louise scene that's in here wasn't in the script, but I felt like that was the more pertinent scene from the movie because he doesn't say much.
Hmm.
And you think for a second when she says to him, you're just a little boy, and she that you think for a second maybe he really gets it. But of course he doesn't, you know, but he's so in character and he just moves on through it. It's a beautiful scene, that scene with Louise, I think. Shot this all against green screen again, and originally it was actually meant to be a part of the filming, wasn't it? The film crew was on here, and he just, after he finished this scene, he just fell in the water and everyone laughed. But I kind of felt like it was more important than that, so it wasn't just the filming of a scene. I kind of felt like it was really a sort of a symbol of him at the end of his life. And it was also, as I said, a film that came out and was successful, and he didn't destroy any of it. And this is such a great symbol of you know, where he was, being the end of his life, I think. And originally on that TV set was something different too.
Yes, but it was him watching over and over again Dustin Hoffman's acceptance speech for the Oscar.
Brilliantly played by Rob Brydon, but we had to... Once again, it just felt like that... The point of the scene became about him losing the Oscar, which is not what it really was. Yeah.
Well, Blake Edwards had told the writers that this event had taken place where they were due to meet in Gestad to discuss the romance of the Pink Panther. And again, as a simple event, I thought it sat very beautifully in the development of the screenplay. With a strange melancholy and a resolve, an artistic resolve within him to not do any more crap. But it's just, well, literally blanketed in a terrible kind of poignant, melancholic, sad sort of sense of distancing from himself and from everyone that he knows and from his career, which feels a little bit like a place of grace, but it's mixed up with very curious and complex sort of emotional qualities.
And I think,
but it's also part of Sellers, his idea of a stunt. You know, it goes back to the days where he would go around and knock on Spike Milligan's door and be standing there totally naked, saying, "I say, do you know a good tailor?" Then close the door, you know. They had these sort of gags they would do, which is why I said to Stephen, can I, rather than just being a completely static figure, can I throw in this rather cunning little eye glance that there's a touch of impish spirit that he would never let Blake know at this point he has inside him. And I also wanted the audience to feel as though there was a little ember of something that represented the great joy and the great subversive pleasure that he gave to a lot of people as an actor.
I mean, I think what's interesting here too is I think Sellers just didn't want to fight Blake anymore. You know, I think he had a huge respect for Blake Edwards, Sellers. Mm. And I think he just didn't want to go in there. As when he realized he didn't want to do any more of these kind of films, then...
In the light of all this, too, Marty Baum told me that it's a curious set of events. The goons had all phoned each other up and said, let's get together at the Dorchester and have big laughs like we used to in the old days. We'll have a big slap-up dinner. Sellers had also phoned Marty Baum and said, look, I've been to see Michael. We've met up in Switzerland and there's been a form of rapprochement and I'd like to change my will on Monday. And of course he died and a lot of the outcome of the plans was he never got to have the dinner with the goons to celebrate the favourite period of his life, and he was probably planning on giving the kids a lot more. Whether they knew that at the time, I don't know. And Lynn Frederick ultimately got the bulk of his estate.
Sellers here at the studio by himself in the original version of this film that played in Cannes, actually is in England and in Australia and other countries, came straight out of the scene with him standing in the snow. And then when we saw it in Cannes, was the first time we'd ever seen the film with an audience. So, you know, there are lots of little changes suddenly you want to make. And one of the changes was at the end in Cannes, they weren't... the sadness and you say the grace that came from the scene in Gestalt was lost because it was immediately replaced by an intellectual idea, you know. And so we tried this version where the film ends and then the credits start to roll, and then just after the first section of the credits roll, we pull out and there's Sellers sort of happy with the film. You know, he doesn't know whether he likes it or doesn't like it.
Yes. Well, it's also Tom Ryan, who's the critic for the Sunday Age in Melbourne. He wrote rather wonderfully. A lot of people seem to have missed this fact, but he described the film as taking place in some kind of cinematic afterlife. And there is a tease, because at the beginning you think, well, maybe Sellers is sitting down to look at the film of his life. But you realise at the end, with the change of camera angle, that he's got director written on the chair. Which fulfills the notion that, certainly what the writers intended, I think, that this film is a film made in the style of a Peter Sellers film, as variable as that might be, by him. He plays most of the people in it, which goes back to the animated prologue at the beginning, hinting at all of those themes. And I must admit, during the shoot, And subsequently, in doing press interviews, people say, when did you think you cracked him, or how much better do you know him now? And I think the film operates on a level of taking you into the worlds of his private life and his professional life and how they keep shifting and changing and feeding on each other. But ultimately, the unknowability of the man, to me, is pretty much the central premise of the film. That to get to know Peter Sellers, you've got to get to know all of those strangely, perhaps partly autobiographical characters that he played in 60 films. Well, that's us. Thank you for listening. I hope you enjoyed. There's a lot of material out there, let me tell you. Go and see the films if you haven't seen them. And read all of the books, because everyone has a different point of view.
Yep, I hope this reignites interest in Sellers, because obviously everyone involved are really big fans of him, and have nothing but the greatest admiration for what he brought into all our lives, I think. And I would do my best Clouseau impersonation, but I think I'll just leave that to Sellers from now on.